First, I'd like to thank the organizers of this nice conference. Yesterday we had a very nice section, poster section. Very different. Around the swimming pool with caipirinha. I'm now with a headache and have to drink water. Okay. This title is a bit complicated. Then I have to say something about it. It's usual to find in the literature that the excitations in artificial square spinels are magnetic monopoles connected by Dirac string, but I think that this terminology is not completely correct. Really, in a research conference in Grenoble, France, Professor Volovic called my attention to the fact that these excitations in artificial square eyes are more similar to Nambu monopoles than Dirac monopoles. Then I, after reading something about it, I must agree with him. I made this little modification in the title, and then it's strange. But I hope that along this presentation, you can understand what I mean. Okay. But what are artificial spinels? No one better than Professor Schiffer to see what they are. Probably he will do this in the next presentation. Yesterday and today, this subject was already introduced. Then I don't need to say so much about it. These are frustrated systems that mimic the usual three-dimensional spinels materials. Magnetic nano-islands with shapes like this have magnetic moments that point along the long axis. This net magnetic moment have an Ising-like behavior in a good approximation. The islands can be organized in several different geometries, in principle the wave ones. Here, I'd like to present some results about the thermodynamics and even about the dynamics of these systems in square eyes, not Kagome, square. In principle, these systems do not exhibit real thermodynamics because a magnetic island contains a large number of spins. However, the concept of effective thermodynamics and even the idea of effective temperature have already been introduced in the literature. On the other hand, from the experimental point of view, a recent work studied the real thermodynamics of a square ice by using a different material to make the islands, not really a permalloy, a magnetic material at an ordinary temperature, near room temperature. Then it should be important to know with more details the properties of these systems, and this is the aim of this talk. We're going to try. To do this, I'm going to use two approaches. In the first, we neglect the internal structure of the islands. Then, an island can be viewed as a point-like dipole with an Ising behavior. In the second approach, I'm going to take into account this internal structure. Then we have to know the dynamics of all spins inside an island. To do this, we have to introduce internal potentials associated with, for example, plane or hard eggs of a single island. The two-dimensional square lattice was the first artificial Spinach produced. It was made by the group of Professor Schiffer in Penn State University. The main interaction among the islands is the dipolar interaction given by this equation, where D is a coupling constant and S represents the net magnetic moment of the island. Our result here will be given in terms of D. In a square lattice, we have four possible topologies for the magnetic moments around a vertex. These topologies is shown here in this figure. The configuration of the four magnetic moments around the vertex with the smallest energy is the one that obeys the Hess rule. However, for example, from the four possible topologies, the two first obey the Hess rule. Two spin mass point in, two mass point out. However, the Hess rule is not degenerate in two dimensions. Real topology 2 has about four times more energy than topology 1. Then, looking at these four possible topologies, we have topology 1, topology 2, we have 2 in, 2 out, Hess rule. Topology 3, we have 3 out, 1 in, or 3 out, 3 in, 1 out. And topology 4, we have 4 out, or 4 in. This is the configuration of the ground state of this system. Of course, the Hess rule is present in all vertices, but with topology 1. There are two possible, because the system is not degenerate, there are two possible ground states, only two possible ground states. Despite predictions, this ground state was not obtained experimentally until last year. It was the group of Professor Merrill's in this work by Morgan et al. Got this state, ground state. Given the ground state, if one violates the Hess rule in a particular position, for example here, then the most elementary excitation arises in the system. It's composed by two effective magnetic charges separated by one lattice space. The two charges are in the configuration 3 out, 1 in, or 3 in, 1 out, topology 3. In principle, these effective charges, opposite charges, can be separated without further violation of the Hess rule. But, however, there is a price to be paid. Topology has to change from 1 to 2 along the road of separation. It costs energy because topology 2 has more energy. And then there is a kind of string connecting this effective charge. Really, the interaction potential between these two effective charges is given by this equation, where the first term is the usual three-dimensional Coulomb interaction between two charges separated by the distance r. The second term is the contribution of a string with tension b and length x. And the last term is a constant, which is part of the percolation energy. The percolation energy is about 29 d. This constant is 23 d. Here, the numerical values of these parameters, we can calculate the magnetic charge using this expression with this value q. Then, we can make an analogy with the work of Castelnuovo, Mosner, and Sondi. And we're going to call these excitations as magnetic monopoles. However, that is, of course, a strong difference, because in the usual spinites, the string connect the monopoles does not have energy. In two dimensions, it does. But I'm going to keep this name. Because of this energetic string, the analogy, similarity with number monopoles is more convenient, in my opinion. You can see some works of Professor Nambu in about 40 years ago. Okay, the question is, could these strings break for some effect, some sword, some like things like this? This is a question that I think I don't have the response yet, but we have the results I'm going to present here may suggest some interesting facts. These excitations were directly observed experimentally. In the same work by Morgan et al., the same work that got the ground state, these authors have also classified these excitations. For example, the most limited excitation is represented by the symbol 1, because it would be two monopoles separated by one large space. The second excited state is a string loop without charge. It's represented by the symbol 4O. The next excited state is two monopoles separated, connected by a string with the shape, then it's 2L, and so on. There are several types of monopoles and strings, energetic strings. These excitations obey the interaction between them is obeys this equation. Okay. Before present some results, I'd like to show this idea in which we can estimate a possible critical temperature for the system. There are several ways of connecting two monopoles by a string. For example, then I think it can generate a kind of configurational entropy, which is proportional to the length of the string. Then, if you calculate the free energy, we have a kind of effective tension B, and this tension would vanish at this temperature, 9.1 D. I think that at this temperature, the system, probably the system would have the string would break. We're going to use Monte Carlo calculations, and I'm not going to give the details of the calculations. We consider this Hamiltonian. We studied several lattice sizes. The first result for the thermodynamics is the density of monopoles and density of string loops for O. The green points represent the density of string loops, and the red point is the density of monopoles. As you can see, there is a maximum in the density of string loops at a temperature near 7.2 D. After that, the density starts to decrease, while the density of monopoles starts to increase. Here you can see typical distributions of string loops and monopoles for temperatures below and above 7.2 D. I think that string loops may form clusters at low temperature that percolate the system at high at a temperature equal to 7.2 D. Probably in this situation we have the coexistence of the two ground states, then monopoles start to proliferate. Here the specific heat, it exhibits a sharp peak at the same temperature, 7.2 D. This peak increases with the system size very slowly, logarithmically, with the system size, which gives an idea of Ising phase transition. Here, I show the average separation between monopoles and antimonopoles, between opposite charges. Then there is a maximum of this separation, this mean separation, at a temperature equal to 7.2 D. This maximum increases as the system size increases logarithmically with the system size. And then we could imagine that in the thermodynamic limits, we could find isolated monopoles at this temperature. But artificial systems are not infinite. We have to consider finite systems. Here I show two typical distributions of monopoles, only monopoles, for temperature below and above 7.2 D. For low temperature, in general, the pairs are small. There is always a string connecting them. However, for high enough temperature, we have some difference. We can find in some place, a few number of poles without strings, pieces of strings without monopoles. then I think that even for finite systems, variable systems, we could find isolated monopoles for a temperature equal or above 7.2 D. Okay, all results presented until now were obtained with the first approach. I mean, the islands were considered as point-like dipoles. Now I'm going to use the second approach. I think it's more realistic situation. Here we have three points that I have to show you. The idea of ionizing spin for a particle is replaced by a 3D magnetic moment moving in some anisotropic potential, but free to point in any direction if enough energy becomes unbelievable to it. This type of potential is continuous, in contrast to the two-state Ising particle, have a well-defined energy barrier. We find that with this condition, Lx, Ly, Lx, Ly, with this condition for the islands, a uniform rotation model is very useful. Then we have to calculate the energetic of the island, of a single island. This equation is very useful for it. We have here a constant K1, which is associated with the EZX, and K3, which is associated with the hard X, ZX, XX. We have studied several types of islands, size, shapes, and things. Then we would like to, what we have to get is this constant, because with this constant we have the shape and the number or the size of the island. And this is the archive recently. Then we can get the constant K1 and K3. I'm not going to give the details. Here we can get K3. And we can calculate some properties like hysteresis loops and things like this along the, for example, the EZX. Note that these spins have this, then they have, this is associated with the motion of the spin out of play. Okay, just for illustration, because these calculations are still in progress, just for illustration, I'm going to use some fictitious constants. The exchange constant equal to zero, K1, 1, K3, 0, G, 0.2. I'm going to start this simulation in a uniform state, a high energy. Then I'm going to wait for the system to start to relax. It's going to start in this uniform situation. The system is relaxing. Note that the ground state starts to grow up along this direction. There is direction, this direction. Then the spins oscillate around out of plane, in plane. Okay. The same. This is a very low temperature. The same situation, but I'm going to start the same temperature, but I'm going to start in the ground state. The system become in this state because it's a very low temperature. Here we can, for example, count the number of monopoles. In the other situation, this number is relatively large, around even for this low temperature. The number of monopoles starts to arise. We can count to 10 monopoles. Here, since it starts in the ground state, we don't see no monopole because it's very low temperature. I increase the temperature, the system becomes. This is not realistic values, okay? It's just for illustration. We are now calculating the real constants to make the simulations more realistic. It's a high temperature, around 7 G. Not that some spins oscillate out of plane, in plane, very confused. The number of monopoles is very high, but of course, if you use K3 different from zero, the system you're going to be less agitated. Probably the results for the critical temperature would be smaller than 7.2, because now the spins have more degrees of freedom, then we have now calculating this possibility. I'd like to thank some Brazilian agents, CNPq, Papemig, CAPS, and I'd like to thank you for.
Yeah, so this unbinding transition, I didn't understand, is that concurrent with the ordinary icing-like order-disorder transition? Does it occur at the same temperature?
Yes.
Okay, so, should it in any sense be thought of as independent of that, or is it just a sort of byproduct, a sort of an apparent byproduct of the order-disorder transition? Do you see what I mean?
Yeah. You say, I think you're right, that is a transition order-disorder, but the two ground states coexist, like an Ising transition.
Okay, so I was just wondering, the transition we've been talking about at 7.2D, in a typical system, what temperatures is that translated?
Yeah, it's very high. Because the D but I think that depending on the material, probably we could have new materials in the future.
Just a quick comment. Although this is the energy scales is clearly very qualitatively very different from quantitatively very different from the three-dimensional case, there is also an ordering transition in dipolar spin ice on a pyrochlore lattice, as we saw in Michel Gingras' talk, Pauling states, although the band is very flat, it's almost flat, it's not completely flat.
Okay, in that case, I'll thank Afranio again for a very nice talk.